Welcome to our last seminar of this semester. Just a reminder that we continue next semester, so please mark your calendars. First Tuesday of each month, as usual. Same time, same place. So, thanks. For those who pay careful attention, you might notice that we have a change in the program for today. Unfortunately, Eric Wood is unable to give the lecture today. But I want to give a special thanks to my good friend Emilcare Corporato, who has agreed to step in and to give us a talk today. Emilcare is the Thomas J. Wu, class of 94, professor of civil and environmental engineering, and also the Princeton Environmental Institute, PEI. Emilcare has broad interests in hydrology and fluid mechanics with a specific focus, oftentimes, in the field that we call ecohydrology, the interface between ecology and hydrology. Indeed, I think it's fair to say that Emilcare's early papers actually form the foundation of the modern field of ecohydrology. He's also written a classic book in the field called Ecohydrology of Water-Controlled Ecosystems, along with our friend Ignacio Rodriguez-Iturbe. Emilcare has been editor for the main journal in our field, Water Resources Research, as well as Hydrological Processes. He has received a number of awards. I just found out that among others that I'll list in a minute, he's now officially a highly cited author in the Web of Science. He's a fellow of the American Geophysical Union. He's received the highest award from the Hydrological section of AGU, which is Hydrological Sciences Award. He was a Borland Lecturer in Hydrology. He was a Lagrange Fellow at the Polytechnic of Turin, and a number of other things. But for now, I will ask you to join me in welcoming Emilcare.
Thank you, Mike. It's a pleasure to be here. Can you hear me? Good. So I have to start with a disclaimer. There will be something like this later on in the talk, and my student teach me that with the Italian accent, these things, especially after lunch, are known to produce really bad results. So this is Xue Feng, my former student, now associate assistant professor at the University of Minnesota. This is Giulia Vico, now associate professor at University of Uppsala, Sweden. And this is just me supervising, of course. You will see their names appearing later on. So the second disclaimer is that while you sleep, you'll be seeing me talking about ecohydrology in very simple models. Now, there is a value in using simple models, I think. First of all, because you can immediately see how these pieces interact together. In a clearer way. And secondly, also, you can see immediately when you are how your model gets balanced or imbalanced. For example, here I think there is a bit too much detail compared to the rest. You can also notice that I paid attention to making the bottom of the cloud flat so that it shows that there is a lifting condensation level that will appear later on. Now, again, my students always push back on this picture. And they say, why don't you add more detail, make things more complicated? And this is, of course, great, but it's a difficult and dangerous business. Also because this, which one is the pointer, these guys interact non-linearly. So when you add details, sometimes you get the wrong result. And of course, this is less of a realistic picture, I think, even if it has more detail. So that's more or less the message here. The talk is divided in two parts. I'll talk about how soil moisture impacts the growth of the boundary layer and how that controls the exchanges of heat and water through between the land and the atmosphere. And in the second part, I'll talk more about the role of plants, type of photosynthesis, C3, C4 chem, and how they impact transpiration and therefore the growth of the boundary layer. This is work done funded by NSF, USDA, and it's done in collaboration with my postdoc, Mark, who should be here, I think, my PhD student Sam, somewhere, and my postdoc Jean. He's not always that serious, don't worry. So, let's get to the talk. Yes, so the focus of the talk is the soil plant system as a complex system. Water moves from the soil-root interface. I'll talk about soil moisture. This is how much moisture there is in the pore spaces of the soil and how that gets uptaken by the roots into the plants through this very intricate network of pipes, the xylem, in all the way to the leaves. This is the beautiful Duke forest, where you have these stomates. Stomates are, from the Greek word for mouths, are these little openings that open and close to let water go out as the CO2 gets in to do photosynthesis, to do assimilation. Now, much of my work, as Mike has said, has been devoted to understanding how rainfall variability, which looks like very unpredictable, very intermittent, propagates into this dynamic of soil moisture up and down. Now, this is not what I'm going to talk about today. I'm actually going to focus on at the daily, sub-daily level, what happens in the, this is Mark. Late as usual. In between rain events, and so there will be no rainfall, there will just be sequences of days in which plants transpire and the soil moisture goes down. So, what happens during a clear day? During a clear day, we have a boundary layer that forms and grows. This is a height, which is as a function of time. And this is, for example, the profile of wind. So we're on top of the canopy. You have the classical logarithmic layer. So the velocity grows, but then it becomes almost flat and constant. This is one of the main points that I want to make. This is the mixed layer. The ABL, the atmospheric boundary layer, is so complicated by turbulence that it becomes simple and well mixed. Okay, on top of that, there is the capping inversion when the turbulence stops, and then you have the free atmosphere where everything is driven by more potential form, by stuff that is less turbulent. Okay, so at the surface, this boundary layer grows in time because there is net incoming radiation, net energy coming in, and which, as it warms up the surface, it divides itself into a component which we call a sensible heat flux. This is true sensible, meaning that it produces changes in temperatures. They're visible with a thermometer, and they're driven by differences in temperature between the surface and the atmosphere and the boundary layer. And this lambda E, which is the latent heat flux. This is related to the fact that some of the energy goes into evaporating water. Lambda is the latent heat of evaporation. E is evapotranspiration, is how much flux of water we plants and soils are pumping into the atmosphere, okay? So the interesting thing is that not only the velocity is relatively homogeneous and flat, but also this theta, sorry for the changes in notation, but this theta is potential temperature, and this is a specific humidity, and those also tend to be relatively constant throughout the boundary layer of height, H. Now, these are measurements at the airport of Greensboro, sounding profiles, and of course they are not exactly flat, but they kind of. And then there is a jump here, not as sharp as I'm going to model it, and above that you have other slopes. These are the so-called lapse rates, how the potential temperature and specific humidity change in the free atmosphere. We will pay attention to this theta F and QF. So specific humidity is just the ratio of how much water there is per grams of water per grams of air. And potential temperature is a special temperature. That's the one that remains constant. It's not the real temperature, but it's weighted by pressure. So as you go up, that's what remains constant. Why is that? If you are in atmospheric sciences, you will, or in thermodynamics, just take the logarithm of this, and you will get that this gives you log of theta, log of T minus log P. That's the entropy of an ideal gas. And so basically what you're saying here is that this is adiabatic mixing. Turbulent mixes stuff fast so that potential temperature remains constant. Okay, so that will be my simple scheme of the atmospheric boundary layer. Now, if you really are not convinced that this is a decent scheme, you can do numerical simulations. This is what people like my colleague Eli does, large eddy simulations. This is the top of the line type of simulations for turbulence. This is from a different paper, but the simulations actually do give us profiles that, okay, the logarithmic layer is here, this is flat potential temperature almost, and okay, the change here is not that sharp, but it's good enough for us. How do we model that? I told you there would be some equations, okay? So if you want to do a simple model of that, you need to at least do an accounting, a balance of water and energy. And so the first one is the conservation of energy. It's how much energy you are adding from the surface, H, the sensible heat flux. This is a complicated term. So dH of T is how fast the boundary layer grows in time. So you're encroaching in the free atmosphere, and depending on the profile that you can get typically warmer temperature, so energy getting into the ABL. This is simply just the rate of change of the amount of static energy, of enthalpy that you have in your system, because you input heat, and that heat goes into internal energy, but also does work expanding towards the higher elevations. This is the energy the water balance. So the rate of change throughout age of the specific humidity is the input of water through evaporation, minus or plus, depending whether this is positive or negative, what you encroach by growing into the free atmosphere. If the free atmosphere is drier, this will make the ABL less humid, or vice versa. And this is an equation that has lots of theory behind, so I'm not going to open that box. I'm just going to refer you to Tenekis in his seminal paper in the Journal of Atmospheric Sciences, where he basically formulated a simple closure of turbulence and how that basically tells us that the growth of the boundary layer depends, is proportional to how much sensible heat flux you have at the surface. Okay, so where are the plants in all of this? Well, so at the surface, depending on how they decide how the partitioning and the soil, how the partitioning between these three terms takes place. So the plants, this is the sensible heat flux, this is the atmospheric conductance, this is the differences in temperature between the surface and the ABL, this is evapotranspiration, you have a stomatal conductance also in series, and you have the internal specific humidity inside the stomates and in the boundary layer. Now, the canopy height controls GA, so that's one effect of plants. We have the incoming energy depends on albedo. Albedo is the fraction of energy that gets reflected away. And that depends, for example, on not only on the color of the surface, but also on the roughness type. And so vegetation height has quite a bit of a role. You can go from almost 30% if you have a barley field or natural pasture, all the way down to 15% in woodlands. But perhaps the more important of all is the control of stomatal conductance, this GS. This tells us how open or closed the stomates are. And this is basically where the biological control is. Plants decide to close their stomates, so to speak, because they want to improve and maximize their assimilation. And if they have too little water in them, even if they keep their stomates open, they are not going to do much photosynthesis. And so this GS depends on A, assimilation of carbon. The assimilation of carbon depends on how CO2 is diffused between inside the stomates and outside the stomates, but also depends on the photosynthesis. This is a complex function that depends on all the chemistry of photosynthesis. Now, without getting into that, this is radiation, this is internal CO2 concentration inside the leaves, this is leaf temperature, and this is the leaf water potential. Okay, so the leaf water potential, that's where you get the connection with from the leaves all the way to the soil. You have a series of resistances, so to speak, that's an analogy that we often use, for the water to get into the leaves. So you have a water potential in the soil. This is nothing but Gibbs free energy compared to free water. So it's zero if you have freely available water. Clearly, it's not freely available in the soil because it's held in the capillaries, so this is negative, and it gets more and more negative as you get into the leaf. No? And here it evaporates inside, and then it gets transported by turbulence outside. Okay. Now, we take all of these equations, and we solve them numerically, and we get this type of results. Now, we need to couple them with an equation for soil moisture. This is soil moisture that throughout 7 days goes down. You see that at night we close the stomach, so nothing happens, at least in this simple model. And we keep going down, and you see that this is the atmosphere is kept the same, the free atmosphere, we just keep it constant. The vapor pressure deficit, the humidity of the atmosphere slowly grows as we get less water in the soil. And evaporation slowly goes down, nothing during the night and open during the day. Assimilation also goes down. You can see the midday stomatal closure that reduces, this is stomatal closure. So all in all, decent results if you compare them with the measurements that my good friend and colleague Gabby Catul at Duke has done in the Duke Forest. So decent results. You see the evaporation day by day. And you see, what is that, CO2 assimilation during the day. And of course, there is respiration of the soil at night, which we're not talking about here. What if you are lazy like me and don't want to go through all the numerical simulation? Is there any way to get insights from analytical solution? Now, this reminds me of what my grandmother used to tell me, that if you try to avoid work, you'll end up doing twice as much work. But I never listened to her, so. And so let's see a little bit this system, how we can get inside from that. So we have the energy partitioning at the surface. We have these three equations. And this form a closed dynamical system. There are lots of nonlinearities. Theta is multiplied by h is multiplied by theta, Q by lot, this is divided by H. It's not easy to see how to proceed. The way to perhaps proceed is to think of this as the dynamical system and study it in the phase space. The way that Poincaré told us to think of this is to construct a space with the variable being theta, Q, and H, and at a moment in time, that point. Then forms a point in that space. And as you evolve your simulation, that point moves in that space and describes a three-dimensional object. By studying that three-dimensional object, you can say what are some of the properties. Now, when we do that, we see immediately that during a day, this three-dimensional object is not really three-dimensional. It's like it lives on a two-dimensional manifold, on a two-dimensional part. And so there is hope, actually, to simplify that. So guided by that, we started looking at the system. And one thing that you notice is that, for example, if you solve for H here and you plug it in here, you get an equation where all the terms have a dH dt, which means that you can immediately integrate in time and get theta linear function of H, which is a very simple result. So as, oops, what have I done? See, I shouldn't have done this. Good. That was easy. So as H grows, theta also grows proportionally. You can do the same with Q and plug this in here and then find the same thing and solve for Q. And the interesting thing that you see is that now you get a memory term. Like, this is not linearly related to H, only this part. And here you have all the integral in time of the previous radiation that you got. So water actually has a memory part. And then you keep going, and you can take these guys, plug them here, and you get a single equation, although complicated in H. If you look at it, it has complicated pieces. These are generic functions of times. I'm not going to mention those, but this is not solvable. But you see from simulation that these guys are almost constant. Now, that gives us hope until we discover that this is a deceivingly simple equation. It's an Abel equation of the second kind that is not solvable. So, and this, look just at the Abel is this famous mathematician from Norway. I don't think he made it to 27. And yet, the mathematicians, what Hermite told of him is that Abel has left mathematician enough to keep them busy for 500 years. So perhaps my grandmother was right. There is lots of work to do here. Okay, we didn't give up. This C depends on VPD, soil moisture. You can do a perturbation to first order. You can actually write the solution this way. This is just a constant. This is T. And this H equilibrium contains just this memory integral term. Now, this can be solved once for all, and you get the M4, the green line, versus the full solution. So at the end of the day, not too bad a solution. But what have we learned of all of this? Well, we have learned that how the pieces interact, and also we have learned how there are memory terms in some parts of the system, and in others there are not. So that's just good to give you an idea. This is what happens during a clear day. The boundary layer grows, and the exchanges between the land and the atmosphere are controlled by the conditions at the surface. But at some point, if the conditions are right, the boundary layer may meet the lifting condensation level. The lifting condensation level is this flat bottom of the clouds that you often see in summer. If you pay attention, you will see that very clearly many times. And this is basically the point at which the water vapor is lifted up, and it meets temperatures that are cold enough to produce condensation. That's where the cloud starts. If the conditions are then right, this condensation releases heat, and then that creates further convection. So you can have an initiation of deep convection. And what we wanted to do with June is to try to see if we could get an idea of what are the controls in the simplified world of this deep convection. So to do that, we first of all have to see how H gets into the lifting condensation level, so when is the timing that happens. That's a necessary condition. But also there is another thing that we need to take into account, which is this so-called CAPE. CAPE, if you're not in this field, is like convective available potential energy. It's this area here between the profile, linear profile of the, almost linear profile, depends, of the free atmosphere, and this moist adiabat. Basically, it's how much heat you would release if you were lifting this, the vapor here, bringing it here, letting it condensate, and that releases heat. Okay, this is actually a scheme that has been used before by Findel and El-Tahir, and we just follow that. Basically, it's conditioning on having large enough CAPE and meeting the lifting condensation level. So June, my postdoc, did some. He likes very much movies and simulations, and so he parameterized the boundary layer model with typical C3 plants. I'll come back to that later. And if you do the simulations, this is a clear day. This is dry soil. This is wet soil. You see that at some point, if the free atmosphere conditions are right, you will get at just after noon and an hour and a half later if you have a wet soil. So there is a difference just because of changes in soil moisture. And you also see the differences in CAPE. In this case, there is much more humidity and available potential energy. Oops, need to proceed. How do I move? Yes, thank you. So the other thing that we can study with these simple models is, for example, the effect now, not of the soil, it will keep soil moisture constant, but of the gamma, of the slopes of the free atmosphere profile. So this is the slope of the potential temperature. This is the slope of the specific humidity in the free atmosphere. So that means that the free atmosphere becomes wetter as we move down and becomes more unstable, meaning that there is warm at the bottom and cold at the top if we move here. And you can solve the system and see when you have for example, check these regimes. So regime one is when you have crossing of the lifting condensation level before sunset. Regime two is when you have no crossing. This is no crossing during the day, and Cape being too small. Cape having crossing but not having Cape strong enough. And this is a regime where there may be deep convection, meaning that you do have crossing and you have enough Cape. Now this should be a greater, sorry. I just realized that now. And you can do a movie again and study, for example, what happens during a dry down. Now I don't know why the other one is not moving. Yeah, the other one should move also. I don't know why. Okay. Ah, there you go. Yes, so you see the soil moisture going down. This is like multiple days, and these are how the conditions would change if we keep the atmosphere constant. So they are simple gains, but they give us some insight. Now, let me switch gear here. And as I mentioned before, these were C3 plants. What does that mean? If you look at photosynthesis, most of the plants do this type of photosynthesis. This is the calving cycle. And what happens is that this guy here, ribulose 1.5 biphosphate, gets CO2 held by Rubisco and produces this C3 sugar, 3-carbon sugar. That's why it's called C3 photosynthesis. And then it keeps going like this. Now, there is a problem with this, that this guy also likes oxygen. So sometimes instead of doing the carboxylase, fixing CO2, it fixes oxygen, which is exactly the opposite of what it's supposed to do. It's like turning backwards the cycle. Now, this happens in all C3 plants about 30% of the time, and it's usually not a problem. It used to be not a problem, at least until the CO2 was very, very high, up to 60 million years ago, and the oxygen was also very low. But after that, it became an issue maybe with some plants, which probably pushed the plants to develop a new type of anatomy, developing the C4 photosynthesis. Now, in that case, there is a CO2 pump where instead of having the guy that likes both oxygen and CO2, now there is this PEP that only likes CO2. It transfers it into malate and then brings it here where there is no oxygen, basically, and then the usual calving cycle can happen basically with no interferences with oxygen. That produces a much more efficient photosynthesis than C4. Now, some of the major crops, including corn, are C4. And they have a different water use efficiency because of that. So if you plot soil moisture and evapotranspiration for a typical C3 and a typical C4 species, you will see a behavior like this. So higher transpiration at high soil moisture for something like corn, less for wheat, but more resistance to water stress for wheat than corn. That's well known, certainly, to agronomists. But the question is, what happens then if you change the parameters in our model? Well, the changes are not huge, but you can see a difference between C4 in red and C3 in black. You see that, for example, the timing of lifting condensation level crossing are slightly different, but this would be every day if you have a different type of surface for this soil moisture. And the height of the boundary layer also changes from something like 1.6 kilometers to more than 2. Of course, this is joules per kilogram, this is Cape. Same story with C3 in this case having more Cape than C4. It depends, of course, on the surface condition. But at least we can start playing these games in this simple world and see how different photosynthesis would work. Especially if you think that what we are doing in many areas of the world is substituting C3 forests with C4 crops. This is sugarcane in Brazil, huge expanses of sugarcane plantation instead of the Atlantic forest. We have corn. This is widely cultivated in tropics and in mid-latitudes, as we know. Sunflower is also a C4 plant. So if you put all of this together, there is a potential for a non-negligible impact. Now, if you really want to know the impact, you shouldn't use this simple model. You should talk to my friends at GFDL, and this is what we're doing in my group with Elena and the other colleagues. But that's at least the idea. Now, there is a third type of photosynthesis that has interested us in our group. This is especially work by Mark and by Samantha. I don't see her here. So this is the third and only remaining type of photosynthesis, which is the crassulacean acid metabolism. So these plants are really interesting because they do, well, these are cacti, very, very water use efficient plants, prickly pear, quite used in Mexico, in Brazil, in Northern Africa as a crop, for feed, for fruits, for fiber. It grows quite efficiently in spite of being a cactus. Now this is the saguaro in Arizona. We have the pineapple, we have orchids. This is the, if you like tequila, this is agave tequilana that also does the agave nectar, so the sugar, and these are other cacti. Now, what these plants have of very different is that they close the stomates during the day and they open the stomates at night. So they do that with the circadian rhythm. They have an internal clock, so much so that if you take a cactus in a lab where there is the light always on, after 8 hours or so, it will close the stomates, very much like our jet lag. So there is this nonlinear oscillator in there. And with the fact that they transpire at night. So there is another aspect that interests us, which is that many of the epiphytes, these aerial plants, that according to some references, can be up to 25 or 30% of the leaf biomass in some tropical forests, are actually chem plants. And the proportion of chem plants grows as you get in the drier environment towards the top of the canopy. Okay, so you can see all of these are chem plants. Now, you will tell me, and this is something that we are exploring again with GFDL, there is no climate model at the moment that has this embedded, this type of photosynthesis. Now, you may tell me, since they transpire very little, they may not have a big impact, which I agree, although if nights are become drier, they may have a bigger impact. But the fact is that if you take all this biomass and you assume that it transpires during the day, you're probably making a bigger mistake. So even just the fact of taking that fraction and taking it away as a normal type of photosynthesis may be a first useful step. So to explore this role, the role of this type of photosynthesis, we have to redevelop the whole soil plant atmosphere continuum model. This was started by Mark in this paper and then continued by Samantha in these other two papers. So what the big changes are, you have the usual resistor that we had before, but many of them are succulents. They store lots of water, perhaps more water in them than what they have in the soil. So you need to add this storage component inside the plant. So that's the big, and this adds a differential equation. So it complicates a little bit the dynamical system. But more importantly, at the leaf level, or whatever you can, I don't know what the leaf of a cactus is, but inside the green part of the cactus, there are these vacuoles, which is where the CO2 gets stored as malic acid during the night to then be used during the day for usual photosynthesis. So you need to get this storage component, and you need to get the circadian rhythm to make sure that at night these guys open, store, and during the day release and do the usual calving cycle with these guys being closed. I think Mark and Sam did a very good job in matching all of these, creating this circadian rhythm, a coupled, this is a nonlinear oscillator that in the phase space produces these loops. This is the opening and closing day and night. And you have the malic acid, and then this is the state of the surface of this vacuum. So it produces nice results. And yes, and it has been, we are using it now. This is going to, this is preliminary work. Part of this is actually being published now in ecological modeling, but this preliminary work, it's a model that Sam has put together in Python, made it available, open source. We call it the Photo Tree model. Anyone who wants to use it, she says it's very easy to use, at least according to her. And then we can compare on equal footing now crops with C3 photosynthesis, like the wheat. We can take the sorghum or corn. These are the three species with which we parameterized it, and or the opuntia, the prickly pear that again is being used quite a bit in Brazil and other places. And when you compare during a typical clear day what happens throughout the plant, you see that the carbon assimilation is slightly less for C3, more intense for C4 as it should, and completely different for the opuntia. You have assimilation at night, and a blip here in the morning when there is enough moisture for the camp plant to switch to a C3 behavior. Camp plants can actually have multiple ways of functioning. They can even recycle their own CO2 that they respire. They're very interesting plants. In terms of transpiration, if we're interested in water fluxes, we can see also the differences between C3 and C4, not dramatic, but very dramatic when it comes to camp plants. Almost nothing here. Basically, this is the end of the night when everything is very moist. So basically, there is no transpiration. Of course, there may be still CO2 uptake, and nothing during the day apart from this little blip when the stomates actually open sometimes. So I think I was afraid of not having enough time, and I'm going faster than I thought, and I just want to conclude by, first of all, showing you this very interesting picture. This has been given to me by Paolo Inglese, professor of horticulture, who is an expert on cacti. This is a prickly pear growing on an obelisk in the middle of Ethiopia. Now, where is the soil? Where is the water? How can it grow? I don't know, but it's kind of a miracle. And look at how many fruits it has. But in conclusion, I just want to make three points, in spite of my being fast in going through the slides. Minimalist model may be caricatures of reality, true, but they may help us distill the essential dynamics, especially when you have strong nonlinearities and feedbacks, like in this case. It's very hard to see how the surface impacts the ABL, because the ABL controls the fluxes at the surface and how the free atmosphere then interacts with all of that. There are very interesting ecohydrological processes, some of which have still to be fully elucidated, like, for example, the role of different types of photosynthesis and how they impact climate, but also how they can be used to our advantage to improve soil, water resources, and especially in semi-arid lands. And so that's all. Thank you. Well,
for a certain kind of biosystem.
Yes.
And so that, if you push all of it, what is the requirement? Is it a switch from C3 to C4?
Well, so the question is, I showed that C4 plants in that example end up having more CAPE. C3. Now, this is just one case. We haven't explored, and this is a good suggestion for June, which we should do a more thorough exploration of when this happens and when not. This was just for one value of the parameters of the atmosphere and one parameterization of the plant. So they do, I mean, the C4 plants pump more water at high soil moisture, and then the thing is inverted. So in that case, I think we were in the case when C3 was pumping more. But I'm sure the higher soil moisture will be the opposite. So it's not that clear. I that was just a specific case. But good point. Yes. Yes, in the GA. GA. So that atmospheric conductance contains the roughness of the surface and therefore the canopy height, but also contains the wind speed. And so typically GA is proportional, actually is non-linearly related to the wind speed. So the more wind, the more coupled the soil and the atmosphere are. That's a good question. I'm always afraid from questions from the guys in the climate.
So the energy balance, you had no storage term, right? Does that matter? I mean, we notice that the ground gets warmer and colder with the diurnal cycle.
Yes. It is important, but not the main driver. Q is not the net radiation. That term Q is typically just the radiation that gets into the soil minus what the conduction into the ground. So there is this indirect accounting for how much heat gets into the ground. Now, but it's not dynamics, it's static, as you said. If you have lots of moisture, if you have open bodies, this equation is completely wrong. You need to have a storage capacity for the heat at the surface, and then that heat can be released during the night or but normally it's not that important, at least on surface, the terrestrial, on the ocean and lakes, of course, it's crucial. Yes.
Warm air coming in at low levels and cold air coming in at upper levels. And so the atmosphere controls on the convection also come into play in addition to land surface control. Do you have a sense of the relative importance of land surface control versus atmosphere control?
Well, no, this is another great question. I think. So basically, one way to account for that is to do exactly what we haven't done here, which is to change those slopes, maybe not every day, but every other day. The typical time scale of changes of these profiles, gamma Q and gamma theta, is every other day. I had this discussion with the Fatih a few years ago. So that's probably how you can account, at least in part, for advection. Now, what is the importance of those two? Again, I'm looking at June. We should do that. I think we should compare the relative importance of changes in soil moisture versus changes, which we only have done it partially. But that's a great point. And we could do it together, Jim. Ben, no questions from you?
Other questions.
This is the problem when you end too early. Then, Matteo.
In a water limited ecosystem, so the stomata will reduce respiration, so we increase sensible lift, and the boundary layer should grow taller, so we put more sensible lift into the boundary area.
Right.
But this one has a counter effect for the plants because it will increase the BPD. because the bundled air will grow taller, become warmer, and drain usually drier air from the free atmosphere and make it so it's kind of counterproductive for the plant. Is there any kind of control and negative feedback?
Well, it's when it's dry, it's bad for the plant. So I agree that closing the storm is will make things maybe drier, and which is a further bad effect on plants. But the alternative is to keep the stomates open, which is even worse, because at that point, if plants keep the stomates open, then the xylem tension, the water inside the xylem becomes. The water potential gets too low and you get cavitation, for example. At that point, you break the continuum of your water column inside the xylem, and that's really bad, for example. Or you dehydrate the leaves too much, and then you break, really destroy the sites, the chloroplast and all the sites of photosynthesis. So I think, I mean, at some point during a drought, there is no choice other than closing the stomates, if you can. Old plants didn't used to have this control. This is something that appeared only 150 million years ago, I think. But old ferns and conifer, so at least the old plants now, I know they just kept the stomates open. Now, the way they close the stomates is because they pump ions, and so it's an osmotic adjustment, and then they can close the stomates that way. Is the photorespiration?
Yes.
Yes.
So the result that you show is that the efficiency in the calculation.
Yes. Yes, yes, yes. So there is photorespiration, and then there is just maintenance respiration, right? This is typical in the. So what we use for photosynthesis, I didn't say it, but in hindsight I could have put more details. It's the usual Farquhar model of photosynthesis for C3. Which is the net assimilation, so it actually has the photorespiration as taken away already. And on top of that, we correct it for leaf water potential, which the Farquhar model doesn't have. So.
Any last question?
Yeah, sure, I'll ask.
Good. Thanks, Ben.
The closure model of the soil potential, the atmospheric potential system.
When you're closing the model, you use some sort of theory that determines the stomatal conductance as a function of your plant conditions, potential conditions, atmospheric conditions. Now, you cited on the relevant slide the Farquhar model, which is maximizing water use efficiency. But I know recently people have argued, including Steve Pakala,
No.
About maximization. So basically, I'm asking how the results are on the model.
Yeah, so this is not the Farquhar-Cowan model of maximization of photosynthesis, the one I mentioned. This is just the standard C3 photosynthesis model of Farquhar that has photosynthesis as a function of internal CO2, leaf temperature, and radiation. There is no maximization. The way we open and close the stomates is by relating stomatal conductance to assimilation with the Norman model, which is just an empirical function. So there is no optimization embedded in it. Yes. So yes, we are avoiding that issue of whether plants optimize or not there. It's just based on data. Whatever the data tell us, we do. This is the Looning Norman, not this Norman model. Yes? What is the family? There are different families. So bromeliads do that. All the aerial plants and the other plants that have this, they hold water in their central part. Cacti all do chem photosynthesis. Some of the orchids and the agave, for example, there are quite a bit, the sedum. There are lots, they're very fashionable now. If you go to Home Depot, they're always on sale. They're beautiful and they're hard to kill, so. What, sorry? Yes. Yes. Crassulacean is the type of acid that they use, so yes. I think I had a discussion with Rob. Crassulacean comes from Latin, which means also fat, right? We clarify that. So. No, C3 plants are the oldest, 250 million year old. The first terrestrial plants were all C3 plants. The C4 came about, well, I mean, I'm not an expert on those things, but from what I read, anything between, I think the first one are probably 60 million years old, and then they really became more popular in the grasslands of Pakistan and so on. Many grasses are C4. Mark maybe remembers that better than I do. Same time. Okay. We have a paper that was kind of a fun exploring the similarities between the evolution of cars and plants. And so it's interesting to see that you have C3 plants that have this core engine like the combustion engine. This is the Calvin cycle. And then as the CO2 became less and less, they added the CO2 pump. It's like the turbocharger for cars, without changing the core engine. The chem plants, to us, looked very much like the hybrid engine. So you have a battery, the storage, and this. And if you don't have variability, it doesn't make sense to have a hybrid. So that was the only adventure in evolution that, otherwise, I'm not an expert.
I'm not in the field or anything, so I was just wondering what's the community thinking about with regard to, say we've got, you know, transition in coming millennia into a high CO2 world again.
Huh.
And what's the kind of goods that wins out in that?
Huh. Well, no, that's a great question, actually. So definitely having more CO2. Oh, yes. So the question is, in the future, or even just now, having more CO2, which are the plants that are doing better? Now, it's very hard to say. So based only on CO2, I would have no doubt that C4 would be doing better, no? That C3 would be back to doing well, because you don't need a pump if you have lots of CO2. However, the water use efficiency is also different. So if at the same time the climate becomes drier, then the C3, it depends on the plants. So, and the temperature also. C4 do better with higher temperature because they require more energy to do the pump. I don't think it's something that can be said very easily. And say again? Yeah. Not even trying to convince myself.
Okay.
but you could argue differently. I mean, I'm sure, and I'm not an expert biologist or ecologist, I'm sure that there are people thinking of these questions that... But...
The most common surprise me in the last answer that one of the courses that Hilbert teaches, he calls environmental thermodynamics. So he thinks about how the environment
to see you.
Yeah, I learned a lot.
Oh, thank you.
These models, are they your personal
yes.
model? So they're distinct from GFD?
Yes, yes. This is made in-house. but they're very simple, so.
And what about nitrogen assimilation?
in the plant.
Yes, yeah, do you have that in your...
Yes, yes. We've done quite a bit of carbon and nitrogen cycling in the soil.
What about in leaves?
We do have, I mean, it's not a simple way to have an effect. So VC max, which is one of the parameter of photosynthesis, depends on leaf nitrogen content. So you do have that, but it's totally minimal. The nitrogen cycle in the plant is complicated.
Thank you.
Thanks, Mike.
Well, maybe we can talk some.